Hi, everyone, and thank you so much for joining us today. My name is Elena Srebnija, and I'm a senior crypto supervision expert here at Latvijas Banka, and I'm really excited to have you all here for what I believe is going to be a really insightful session on licensing opportunities for CASPs in Latvijas Banka. So whether you're new to this world of CASPs or you've been navigating the space for a while, today's session is designed to give you a clear understanding of the licensing and supervision process, the opportunities, and of course, the innovation possibilities happening right here at Latvijas Banka. So, topic, in my honest opinion, is very hot. The crypto asset market has been growing an incredible pace, but up until now, the regulatory landscape across the EU has been pretty fragmented. Each member state had its own approach, making things a bit tricky for businesses operating across borders. And that's about to change. With the new MiCA regulation coming into force, we'll have a harmonized approach and a comprehensive framework that covers everything from the issuance of crypto assets to the services provided by crypto asset companies. And this is a great news for businesses because it provides a clear legal playground and set of rules that supports innovation while keeping participants safe. So as regulators, our main goal is to keep customers safe. And MiCA makes sure that service providers are transparent and accountable with the solid rules in place to protect the security of platforms handling things like custody, trading, and exchange of crypto assets. And that's something we'll be focusing on in today's webinar. So let me quickly walk you through today's agenda. First up, we'll cover the licensing process for CASPs at Latvijas Banka, everything you need to know to get licensed. Next, we'll shift to the AML requirements and checklist, outlining the key steps to stay compliant. Then we'll talk about the supervision of CASPs and what you can expect once you're licensed. After that, we'll introduce the Digital Operation with Resilience Act, or DORA, and how it impacts you as a CASPs. And finally, we'll wrap up with a look at the regulatory sandbox. It's a great opportunity to test and grow your services in a controlled environment. But before we dive in, just a quick note. We'll be addressing questions that were submitted during the registration process throughout the webinar. If you have any additional questions during today's session, feel free to drop them in the Q&A section. And while we may not get to all of them live, but don't worry, we'll review them and answer them after the webinar and publish those responses on our website, fintechlatvia.eu, later. Okay, I know licensing can sound a bit formal and maybe even a little intimidating at first, but don't worry. Our goal today is break everything down to simple terms, practical. So you leave feeling confident about the steps you can take to leverage these opportunities. So without further ado, I'll hand it over to my colleague Guna, who will tell you more about licensing opportunities here in Latvijas Banka.
Thank you, Elena. I will just take the control. So hello, and I think Elena already introduced a lot about MiCA regulation, what it is for, and therefore I will skip forward quite quickly the basics and get on to the licensing part quicker. So yes, why MiCA? Obviously, we all know that Europe is not home to the biggest cryptocurrency companies today, but Europe definitely wanted to have a common understanding of the crypto market across the Union, And therefore, MiCA was created, and it creates clear rules for the local players. And as Elena said, that it covers asset issuance and trading and exchange and licensing and supervision, all those matters. The journey to full implementation of MiCA was quite quick compared to other regulations. And therefore, it's been quite a ride for also for the regulators. As you can see, that entry into force was just 2023, and already at the end of this year, the regulation has applies in full. In between, during this year, European institutions and us as well have worked really hard to develop all the necessary delegated regulation. And on European level, it is still in process, a couple of regulations. But the main parts are already published. And starting 30 December 2024, we will have clear understanding how to how the license is obtained and what is the supervision requirements. It has to be mentioned that the regulation offered a longer transition period for existing CASPs and crypto asset service providers, but Latvia chose to shorten this transition period. So the existing market players that are registered with revenue service will have to obtain the new license by June 30, 2025. But it's still a long way, a long time, and enough time to get this license for those players. Moving forward, what MiCA covers? So MiCA definitely covers the crypto asset service providers, that those entities that provide one or more crypto asset services listed in the regulation. And here MiCA follows a bit something similar, this framework as in MiFID regulation, where the services are quite clearly listed and explained what are they. But if we or you don't understand fully, clearly enough what this particular service is, you definitely can fall back on MiFID regulation. It has been around for a number of years, and it definitely helps to understand and explain some of the MiCA provisions. Other subjects that are covered are the issuers of crypto asset crypto assets, and those are entities that also have a control over the creation and then the creation of these assets. And other market participants, existing market participants like banks, investment firms, e-money institutions, alternative investment funds, managers and regulated market operators, central security depositories, UCITS management companies. So these are not all existing market participants that can work in the MiCA environment without additional license, but these are specifically listed in MiCA regulation. For example, there is no payment institution. If it wishes to provide some of the crypto asset services, they have to obtain a CASP license. And there are also exceptions from MiCA, where MiCA does not apply, for example, central banks, also liquidators and administrators in the course of insolvency procedures, and persons who provide crypto asset services exclusively for their parent companies or subsidiaries. So the regarding the assets that are covered by MiCA, here it's wide scope, and it might be a bit difficult to understand that, but we have also created a guide that might help you qualify your particular case, your particular asset, where does it fall in. So definitely covered by MiCA are e-money tokens. Those are the asset tokens that are issued by banks or e-money institutions. And they are definitely referenced to a certain currency. And one might keep in mind that all e-money tokens will be considered as e-money under the existing regulation, but not all e-money will be considered e-money tokens. Other category is asset reference tokens, which purport to maintain a stable value for referencing to another value or rights, and can be also referenced to a currency. And both those categories may become significant tokens due to their volume or potential wide impact on the union financial market. And then their activities are supervised not by the local supervisor, for example, in our case, Latvijas Banka, but by European Banking Authority. And then there are the rest of crypto assets, which also include virtual currencies, but that do not fall into asset reference token or e-money token category. And to a certain degree, they are also regulated. But there are also exceptions, for example, non-fungible tokens, and securities tokens, and also such tokens as utility tokens that are also not regulated by MiCA. One must say that also decentralized financial protocols are not under MiCA. There are more exceptions where one might not need a license for providing crypto services that are connected with crypto assets. And these exceptions more or less cover situations where there's the volume is not, the value is not high enough, the persons involved are insignificant, and where this the scope of the crypto asset where to whom it is provided is limited, like limited network. Also, exceptions cover other situations where for example, the utility tokens or the tokens that are only created for the maintenance of validation and distributing ledger. And therefore, these are not considered to be high risk, or they're necessary for this environment's existence. So let's move on to the crypto asset services. And here, definitely, MiCA went the MiFID way, listing the crypto asset services. You definitely see something similar there. like providing custody and administration on behalf of customers, operation of trading platforms. It's all seen in MiFID as well. Exchange of crypto assets for funds in exchange for crypto assets for other crypto assets. It should be mentioned that the service provider uses its own proprietary capital for doing this. Also, execution of orders on behalf of customers, it's also the same as MiFID, providing advice, individual consultations on crypto assets, portfolio management, the same as MiFID, placing of crypto assets, that's more or less marketing of crypto assets, reception, transmission and of orders. This is where definitely the service provider uses only the customers' assets and customers' funds, and not his own proprietary capital. And providing transfers on behalf of customers, that's also a separate service. And here you can see the existing market participants, what services they can provide without requiring to obtain additionally a crypto asset service provider's license. So if you are a credit institution, you can provide all crypto asset services, issue asset reference tokens, e-money tokens. MiCA states the procedure and the content of documentation that existing credit institution has to submit if it wishes to provide some of the crypto asset services. Other market participants, also investment firms as well, it's the same as credit institutions, but other market participants have limited options what they can provide without having to obtain additional license. And they are more or less connected to their existing services based on are the risks similar, are the operations are similar, or so. And then, I'm sorry, it doesn't work. Okay. Other relevant issues, because before we're delving in the authorization process, are just a couple of things. Now they're in a different timeline. There are consultations. There are changes in progress in commercial law regarding fixed capital that will be able to be paid by stable coins. And also the market has championed initiative that the taxes and other payments should be also be payable by stable coins and crypto assets. And State Revenue Service is open to such options, and the negotiations are ongoing. And at least for now, Revenue Service does not see any particular obstacles to that. I should already mention that compared to other member states, Latvia, maybe you know, maybe you don't know, we practice a tailored approach to authorization process and supervision, and that allows us to help more participants, applicants to choose the best business model that they can and wish to provide. We have introduced and planning to introduce the supervision fees and application assessment fees that are smaller than in other member states. So let's move on to the authorization process. We have on our website already published comprehensive guide on the whole process. You can find the links to regulations, requirements, documentations, and also here you see the step-by-step explained guide how we do things, what we expect from you, at which stage, what you can expect from us in each stage, and how the process is going. So, as I mentioned, we have a tailored approach to each application, and what it entails that and what we can provide is this pre-licensing process, which is preparatory stage. Which means that we meet with each new potential applicant before the official submission of the authorization package. So what we do at this stage is we look through the business model, clarify which services the applicant wishes to provide, help them to decide which services they actually will provide, because usually you have, from the user experience point of view, we provide this and that, but it doesn't necessarily correspond to the, and clearly correspond to the services that are listed in the regulation. So we help to connect these two sides. We also look through and examine shareholders, potential officials, and we definitely examine the initial information on origin of funds. And if that's all fine, we move on also and help to examine applicants' prepared initial AML risk assessment on the chosen business model. And this is we do this because we want to eliminate any major holdouts before the official licensing process, because you have to pay for the process, you will have to invest a lot of time in it, money in it, and for this process to go smoothly, we just go through and give an initial go ahead to heads up for this planned activity. And after we have agreed on the business model and all the issues I mentioned before, the applicant can be sure that preparation of the whole application package is easier, it's clearer, and there are no hidden issues that might stop the licensing process. So the regulation and the delegated regulation comprehensively states the lists all the documents that need to be prepared, procedures, policies, what needs to be put inside the documents, the content, what it should contain, and also, the regulation also regulates the time frame, how this licensing process is carried out, and also upon submitting the complete authorization documentation package, applicant has to pay the application fee, which is 2,500 euros. And then within the 25 working days, Latvijas Banka assesses does the initial assessment if the application is complete. Is all the documentation there? All the information required is there? If not, we contact immediately the applicant and request for additional information. and we set the deadline for this submission of additional information. This is the requirement from the MiCA regulation also. After the application is complete, next 40 working days, are the assessment of the application. We engage the experts, the AML experts, the business experts on the supervision business side, and evaluate all the documentation in detail. At this point, there might be also holdout and request for additional information, but if all the previous stages are followed and all the consultations have taken place, the likelihood of holdout at this stage is relatively low. And after the assessment, the board of Latvijas Banka makes a decision to issue a license. And along the decision, we inform the applicant or the new market participant of the information on the cooperation with the supervisor, on the technical details, how the supervision will go, how you contact us. We register on our website as well, so it's public information. And the supervision then begins. Okay. So this is basically the application process. Some additional information. We're almost done. These are what you see here are the basic requirements for traditional market participants, like internal control systems. That's, I think, the household name in every financial market participant. But maybe these are not common in existing CASPs, in existing crypto service providers that have until now done their business as they know, as they want to do it. But MiCA regulation basically it's an entry point for CASPs to enter the big financial market. And therefore, they also have to follow some basic requirements that are common to other existing market participants. For example, the internal control systems, how they have to be built, what has to be taken into consideration. It's all in the delegated regulations that are issued after MiCA. Handling of complaints, and they have to be procedures in place. Initial capital requirements based on the difference, what particular services CASP wants to provide. So it can be €50,000 or it can be €150,000, depending on the service you want to provide. Also, the banks that are willing to act as custodians must also develop special internal control systems, new policies, because they will have to take responsibility for the client assets that are lost, for example, in cyber attacks. Trading platforms have to introduce abuse detection reporting systems as well. So there are various requirements that have to be introduced, and it's not about the documentation only about documentation. It's about the systems that have to be developed and implemented. So for the existing CASPs, that could be challenging to change some of their initial existing workings. But for the newcomers, it's good to know this in advance to keep in mind when all the systems are developed at the developing stage. Then the next steps, what we ask you, if you are a next market participant, applicant, or existing CASP that wishes to obtain the license from 1st of January, all the consultants that are looking to consult their potential clients, what we definitely suggest you to do is get to know our website, our information and our licensing guide. Existing CASPs work on your systems, internal control systems, adapt them according to the requirements. Evaluate the purchasing of analysis tools, because AML requirements are in force, and you'll have to have the tools to manage your AML risks. And definitely utilize the pre-licensing stage or preparatory stage, and contact us. The consultation is for free, and individual and confidential. This can be done at any stage. You have a plan, a business plan, you don't have systems yet, this is the time you can come to us and for the consultation to see how to move forward with your plan. And yes, and I think that's it for me for now. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Guna, for that insightful presentation. I hope that gave everyone a clear understanding of what to expect when applying for a license at Latvijas Banka. Now, to dive deeper into another critical area, AML requirements, I'll hand things over to my colleague Maija, who will guide you through what CASPs need to know to stay compliant.
So, good morning, everyone. I hope you can hear me well. My name is Maija, and yes, as Elena already mentioned, I will guide you through AML requirements and checklists. So my presentation will consist of four basic points: AML regulatory expectations, AML regulatory framework, AML checklist, what it is and what it includes, and then I will finalize my presentation with questions and answers. You submitted some questions during your application to this webinar. So, as regards AML regulatory expectations, so one of the first things that we would expect is that you have clear, transparent business model, and especially if that is more sophisticated, then we also expect and would very much appreciate some visual, graphical visualization or presentation. Then regarding physical presence in Latvia, what does that include? Basically, that means the following: that day-to-day control and decision-making is carried out from Latvia. The decisions of the board must be taken in Latvia, and we expect that some employees would also work in Latvia. As well as the AML responsible person must be easily accessible to the Latvian supervisors. The next, the AML responsible person is accessible, and it has understanding of local Latvian AML framework regulations and legislation. The another expectation will be that the basic account is opened with a credit institution or payment institution licensed in European Economic Area, and then that your entity would have transparent ownership structure with understandable and UBOs that are that we can identify, as well as we expect transparent share capital with a clear origin. Then our expectation would be that our cooperation, you and we as supervisors, that it would be focused and aimed at transparency and compliance. The board members and AML officers should participate in licensing interviews. AML responsible persons and AML employees, they should have knowledge of blockchain and also understanding how crypto assets, specifically crypto assets, not basic AML, but crypto assets, how they could be used in money laundering, terrorism financing, proliferation financing, and sanction evasion. And then as well, when you would submit your documents describing your internal control system, then as well, we would expect that they're high quality and they can be applied in practice. They're practical, they're not formal, but they meant that employees would be able to use them and work with them. Then as well, for certain CASPs, we would expect that they already would have blockchain analytics tool for transaction monitoring prior they start servicing customers. And in some cases, supervisors could ask to present, to come on site and check how does it work, and would ask you to guide through this these tools that you're using in order to be sure that they're actually working. As well, the licensing stage, would also like to know the trade name your company is going to work and the wallets you're planning to use. And and then last thing, we would also, our expectation is that we will require to submit quarterly reports from different kind of perspective on volumes, customer base, this should be submitted on quarter basis. Let's move to AML regulatory framework. Of course, Latvijas Banka and operates under EU framework and umbrella, so AML directives, regulations, regulation on transfer of funds. This is all should be considered as mandatory applicable, as well as EBA different guidelines about MLTF risk factors also how to apply this travel rule. You should consider that as mandatory. Legislation in Latvia does not repeat this, but it's expected that you follow all of these requirements. As regards AML law, we made a few amendments on local level, and few of them are that crypto asset service providers are going to be financial institutions, which means that all those requirements that are already in the law applicable for financial institutions, they will be applicable also for CASPs. For example, regarding correspondent relationship, you have to take into account what is expected. In case you onboard other crypto asset service provider, you will have to apply all those requirements also for your entity. As well, as regards independent audit, internal audit is mandatory for everyone, but current proposed amendments in AML law would say that that crypto asset service providers would need also external audit, but with permission of supervisor, in some cases it would be allowed in case the risk is lower, in case business is not that sophisticated, supervisor could allow some exemptions in case of that. As well as proposed amendments in the AML law says that in case of occasional crypto asset transfers starting from €1,000 and more, customer due diligence has to be applied. As regards AML regulations, Latvijas Banka currently is in the process to reissue a number of regulations, AML regulations, and in most of the cases in those new regulations, as well crypto asset service providers, the minute they will become they will come under supervision of Latvijas Banka, it's December 30 of this year, in all those regulations, the minute the CASPs are becoming financial institutions, these requirements will be applicable also to crypto asset service providers. And Latvijas Banka has issued AML guidelines. It as well, there's going to be a chapter regarding financial institutions, which is expected to be applicable also for crypto asset service providers. But we're in the process to develop also separate explanation regarding crypto asset service providers. This also is going to be covered in AML guidelines and expected that it will be available by end of this year or starting next year. AML checklist, what it is. Basically, those are 8 elements of internal control system, which are checked also during inspections. I will not go very deep into the details as the time is limited. I will more focus on some specifics which are relevant for crypto asset service providers. All these elements are they cover both money laundering, terrorism financing, proliferation financing, and sanction risk. So all your internal control system should cover all these risks. First of all, risk assessment, it covers methodology, it covers risk assessment itself, and you should also cover under this also sanction risks. As regards crypto asset service providers, we are planning to supplement this AML checklist for risk assessment in case you are providing, let's say, portfolio management services, or you plan to invest crypto assets some further. You also have to take into account and assess money laundering, sanction risk, terrorism financing risk. Also for those investments, those crypto assets, where you're planning to invest your customer assets as well. You have to include and cover it under your risk assessment and describe what's the inherent risks and how you are mitigating it. So it's expected that you include all of that. Risk management strategy, management culture, it's about your company's AML and sanction policy. Governance, that means, and also including cooperation with third parties. It means your organizational structure, management, reliance of defense, AML responsible persons. You have to describe under this. Customer due diligence process. It's about identification, if you use on-site, remote, how you do it, procedures, policies, methodology. You have to cover also occasional transactions, enhanced due diligence. Risk scoring is also under this one. And our current AML checklist, it says that credit institutions are mandatory to have automated risk scoring system. But in case if your business model is international customer base, with large international customer base, the operations are sophisticated, then it would be expected that your risk scoring system, in case you are a crypto asset service provider, that it's also automated. Transaction monitoring system, it needs to be tailored and specific for your business, for the risks your company is exposed. It can be both manual and automated, but again, if your business is international with wide customer base, with large amount of transactions, we expect that it's automated and that that you use blockchain analytics tools, and these tools are tailored to your business specifics, that it covers, it is able to identify high risk transactions, suspicious transactions, tailored to your business model. And also, if you choose this blockchain analytics tool, it should cover also those cryptocurrencies that your company is working with. It should cover all these currencies. It should be able to identify transactions, high-risk transfers with sanctioned addresses, with addresses that are related to darknet market scam, usage of mixers, tumblers. It should be able to identify transfers with self-hosted addresses. And as I mentioned in the beginning of my part, my presentation, we as supervisors might come and ask you to demonstrate how does it work in practice. And if you are able to identify these transactions and your tools are working properly, then suspicious transactions and reporting to FIU, that also must be both procedures, processes, how it's going to be implemented. It should be all prepared and described. And then about IT tools, usage of IT tools, you have to describe what tools you're using, how you're going to ensure quality control of these systems, compliance with regulations, how it's going to be reassessed, updated, and etc. And then, of course, about the procedure, about the independent audit function, you are required to have independent internal audit, and then depends on the risk level and your the business model of your CASP, that you are required to have external audit as well. And in this case, I would like to say that it's a great tool to demonstrate and for you to assess your systems. External audit may perform this assessment, and you can have a full picture you can be more confident how your internal control system works, as well as it's also for the supervisors. It's very helpful that you go through the external audit, and in the case of some lower risks, you may get this exemption not required to have this external audit. But in case of high risk, we expect that you are going to have this requirement as mandatory. And what else I wanted to say about this AML checklist, this is also as AML licensing guidelines. We call them also AML licensing guidelines. And at the moment, in our website, Latvijas Banka website, for each of the sectors that we supervise, you can find these guidelines. But we're planning that in the following weeks, we will supplement and publish these guidelines, which would cover also these CASP specific requirements and would be available for all of you. Yeah, and so during registration for this seminar, you also submitted a few questions. Regarding this AML audit requirements, so as I said, internal audit is mandatory. External audit, first of all, it should be treated as a tool for you to assess your internal control system, that you can be more confident. You can be more confident about your system, how it works. If or maybe there are some loopholes or some deficiencies. Therefore, it's required that for higher risk services that you would go through this process. Then regarding off-chain data and if that would need to be submitted, then yes, my answer is that we will also ask the volumes, the customers involved that you will have to submit some selected information about these off-chain transactions that you have internally in your company. And the last question about eligibility of 100% non-EU residents as UBOs of a potential licensee. I mentioned a few slides ago about this physical presence in Latvia, what is expected as regards UBOs. Then, of course, the most important criteria would be this transparency, that we can identify them, as well as this also the source of share capital, that it can be proved that we have a full picture of the origin of it, as well as about the UBOs, that they are their reputation and its impeccable reputation. We have no doubts about this person. And then regarding non-EU national or Latvian legal and actual resident, if that could be accepted as a director of the prospect licensee. I explained that we expect that decision making would be performed or in Latvia. That is one of the criteria. And as well, MiCA regulation says that the board member, at least one board member, should be a local person. So if you comply with these requirements and expectations, then we expect that yes, you can become a director or a board member, if I understand you correctly, of the crypto asset service provider. Thank you. I think as regards AML part, went through all the main topics.
Okay, thank you so much, Maija. That was a great presentation, and the AML checklist is super helpful. Now, let's move on to the supervision. And today I'll be walking you through the supervision process and the key requirements for crypto asset service providers to get licensed and operate within our regulatory framework. And we'll be covering the main things you need to know to stay compliant and run your business smoothly. So let's dive in. But before we get into the supervision process, let's talk about what we expect from new market participants looking to obtain a CASP license. Because it's important to understand these key requirements upfront to ensure a smooth cooperation. And first up, everyone in key positions at your company, whether it's CEO, board members, or senior staff needs to be trustworthy and capable. Basically, they need to be honest, qualified, and good at making sound decisions. When it comes to reporting, it's not just about hitting deadlines. Your reports need to be detailed and give a clear picture of what's going on in your business. So no vague numbers or excuses, just quality information delivered on time. your business needs to have an office or some kind of physical presence here. This isn't just for the show. It helps us to keep in touch and make sure you're running your operations within the country. You also need a solid plan for managing any conflicts of interest. Simply put, you have to make sure that your team's personal interests don't get in the way of doing what's best for the company and your customers. Also, make sure you're keeping your customers' money and crypto assets separate from customers' funds. This keeps things clean and safe, because customer funds and crypto are for customers, not for running your day-to-day operations. You should have a clear idea of what your business does. Be able to explain easily what services you offer and how you fit into the bigger market. You should really know what you're doing and why. Also, your financial projections need to be realistic. Basically, show you have a plan for growth, where your revenue is coming from, what your costs will be, and prove your business can keep going in the long run. You need someone responsible for IT security, someone who makes sure your systems are safe from hacks and data breaches. Even if you hire someone external, make sure there is a clear go-to person for this, and also have a solid cybersecurity plan in place. Your internal procedures need to match the size of your business. Understand the risks involved in your operations and have a proper steps in place to deal with them. And everyone in charge should know what's going on with the risk management. They need to keep the board in the loop, making sure risks are being handled the right way at all levels. And finally, stay in touch with the regulator. Communicate regularly, respond quickly, and provide solid, accurate reports without delays, because being proactive and transparent builds trust with the regulator. Now, let's shift our focus to the supervision of CASPs. We have a very fast-paced world of crypto, where supervision is all about finding the right balance. And at Latvijas Banka, our job is to make sure CASPs run safely, follow the rules, and straight transparent. Okay, what does that mean in practice? This is how our supervision process actually works here at Latvijas Banka. And first up, we have the supervision planning. This is where everything starts. All supervisory activities are strategically planned 1 year in advance to ensure efficient oversight and resource allocation. We have a dedicated and certified team. Our team is really highly specialized with the right certification and expertise to understand the needs and challenges in the crypto space. And this isn't just about traditional finance. We've tailored our supervision specifically for CASPs. And that's why we also use advanced crypto supervision tools to stay on top of everything. But one thing that set us apart is our dialogue-centered supervision, because we believe in keeping an open line of communication with CASPs. It's not just about enforcement. It's about having ongoing discussions, providing guidance, and working together to ensure compliance. We take a distinct approach from traditional banking, because we recognize that CASPs operate in a completely different space. So we're not applying the same rules or methods we use for traditional financial institutions. So don't worry, we won't treat you as a bank. And last but not least, we use a risk-based approach. We focus on identifying and mitigating the highest risk first. And this way we can concentrate on what matters most for both CASPs and the financial system as a whole. Now, let's take a closer look at Latvijas Banka's risk-based supervision approach. And we start with a report analysis. This is where we dig into the data you provide, especially around compliance with the financial requirements. We're making sure the numbers add up and that your operations align with the regulations. Next, we examine your business model, and this includes looking into your service structure and the volumes you're handling. We also schedule meetings with the management and responsible employees. And these discussions give us deeper insights into how your organization is run and to understand your strategy, your internal processes, and how risks are managed on your end. And our supervision is a combination of offsite and onsite supervision. And in about 90% of cases, we rely only on offsite supervision. And this allows us to keep a close eye on your operations, but without a necessary disruption to your day-to-day activities. And when necessary, we also conduct on-site supervision to get a direct view of your operations and ensure everything is running smoothly. Now, let's talk about the prudential requirements under Article 67 of the MiCA regulation. This is one of the key areas that CASPs need to be aware of because it directly impacts your financial setup. Essentially, MiCA requires that CASPs maintain prudential safeguards at all times. And this means you need to have enough financial resources in place and ensure the stability of your operations. And the required amount is based on whichever is higher of the following two options. And first, the amount of permanent minimal capital requirements, which varies depending on the types of crypto asset service you provide. And second, 1/4 of the fixed overheads from the previous year. Now, when it comes to prudential safeguards, there are a few options available to meet the requirements we just discussed. And these safeguards can take form of own funds or an insurance policy, or you can also use a combination of those options. Moving on to regulatory and implementing technical standards. MiCA provides the overall framework, but the more detailed policies and requirements are delegated to ESMA and EBA. And these bodies are responsible for developing specific standards that offer clearer guidance on how to comply with MiCA's provision. The links on this slide will be published later with a recording of this meeting, and they will take you to finalized documents and those still in progress. And it's important to remember that many of these standards are still being developed and will be published over a time. Next, let's look at the fundamental requirements that every CASP must follow. And firstly, CASP must act honestly, fairly, and professionally. There's the need for robust governance arrangements. This means having solid plans in place for compliance, business continuity, information security, and record keeping. A major obligation is the safekeeping of clients' crypto assets and funds. Providers must protect clients' assets, especially in cases of insolvency, and prevent any misuse of these funds for their own purposes. There are also a lot of specific requirements for CASPs, and these can vary depending on the type of activities your business is involved in. And we won't dive too deep into the details here, since all of this is covered in Chapter 3 of MiCA. But let's walk through some of the key requirements you need to be aware of. And for custody and administration of crypto assets, CASPs must establish a custody policy that ensures the safekeeping or control of crypto assets. And if you're using a third-party services for custody, make sure they're MiCA authorized and inform your clients about these arrangements. And finally, you are responsible for any liability related to the loss of assets or access due to incidents caused by CASPs. Next activity is operation of trading platforms. Platforms are not allowed to deal on their own account. You must ensure pre- and post-trade transparency to the public. Transactional data must be available to national authorities for at least 5 years and ensure transparent and fair fee structure without encouraging unfair trading or market misuse. If you exchange crypto assets, you must have a non-discriminatory commercial policy. There is also an obligation to publish a firm price or provide a method for determining the price of crypto assets. And lastly, you are responsible for the publication of transactional data, including volumes and prices. And next one is the execution of orders on behalf of clients. CASPs must meet the best execution obligation and be able to demonstrate that orders were executed according to policy. And if there are any material changes to execution arrangements or policy, you need to notify your clients about that. When it comes to reception and transmission of orders, it's crucial to avoid any misuse of information related to pending client orders or prevent employees from misusing this information. And additionally, there should be no rewards, discounts, or other benefits offered for routing client orders to a particular trading platform or another CASP. And the last activity we'll cover today is advice and portfolio management. You need to ensure you give clients full details of all costs and charges. And if advice is offered on an independent basis, then no reward rule applies. And always warn your clients about any potential losses and inform them that there may not be investor compensation or deposit guarantee schemes in place. Okay, we covered obligation for CASPs depending on their services. And now let's have a look on Title VI of MiCA about prevention and prohibition of market abuse involving crypto assets. And firstly, let's clarify what Title VI applies to, because it applies not only to CASPs, but also to any person who professionally arranges or executes transactions of crypto assets. And this includes key activities such as operating a trading platform, receiving and transmitting orders, executing orders, and issuing and offering crypto assets. And firstly, MiCA defines inside information, and it's important to understand exactly what this means. Inside information refers to precise information that hasn't been made public and directly or indirectly concerns crypto assets. So in other words, if this information were to be made public, it would likely have a significant effect on the prices of those crypto assets. Now that we know what inside information is, the next question, what do we need to do with it? And this brings us to the topic of public disclosure. Issuers, offers, and persons seeking admission to trading are required to inform the public as soon as possible when inside information directly concerns them. And this disclosure must ensure fast access to the information and that it's correctly and timely, allowing the public to assess it properly. The disclosure must not be combined with marketing to avoid any confusion. And it also needs to be published on the website and remain accessible for 5 years. And in some cases, you can also delay the disclosure if specific requirements are met, but don't forget to inform about that your NCA. Moving on to market abuse, there are three main types of market abuse defined by MiCA. We will go through all of them. And first is insider dealing. This term refers to the use of inside information by someone to buy or sell crypto assets based on information that hasn't been made public. And this information could impact the price of those crypto assets. And there are also strict prohibitions in place to prevent insider dealing, including prohibition on engaging or recommending to engage in insider dealing and on issuing any recommendations based on inside information. Second type is unlawful disclosure of inside information. And this occurs when someone who possesses inside information unlawfully discloses it to another person. And the key here is that disclosing inside information is only allowed when it's done in the normal course of employment, profession, or duties. In all other cases, sharing information inside information is strictly prohibited. And finally, the market manipulation, which involves various actions intended to distort the market. And this can include manipulative transactions, trading or placing orders that give a false or misleading impression of the price of crypto assets, using tricks or misleading methods to change the price of crypto asset, and spreading false information to confuse investors and fairly impact the market. And obviously, all these practices are strongly prohibited. Next one is prevention and detection of market abuse, and anyone involved in arranging or executing transactions in crypto assets must have effective systems, procedures, and arrangements in place to both prevent and detect market abuse. And one key tool for this is the suspicious transaction order report, and for traditional marketplace known as TOR. And this is report used when there are any suspicious activities such as orders, transactions, cancellations, or modifications that suggest market abuse. And these reports need to be submitted to a relevant national authority. Additionally, there are ESMA regulatory technical standards that provide guidelines on the systems, procedures, and templates that should be used for preventing and reporting market abuse, which is in the consultation stage right now, but the draft is still available. And the last thing I wanted to cover in my presentation is ESG risk, because we all know that crypto can be controversial when it comes to sustainability, especially with concerns about the environmental impact of the certain consensus mechanisms. And that's why it's crucial to address these issues through proper disclosure of environmental impacts. So in your white papers, there's need to be a disclosure of environmental impacts, including information on the principal adverse effects on the environment, such as climate-related impacts of the consensus mechanism. And on your websites, you must disclose the principal environmental impacts on the climate and other environmental aspects related to the consensus mechanism. And the level of disclosure and requirements are based on CASP activities and differ based on the type of crypto assets and the energy consumption of their consensus mechanism. And to help you with this, ESMA also provides standards on sustainability indicators, focusing on climate and other environmental related adverse impacts. And a link will be also available later with the recording. Okay, as we wrap up, I wanted to highlight some additional resources that we've prepared to help you navigate the licensing and supervision process. We've put together a guide that walks you through the licensing process that my colleague Guna already mentioned previously, and also a guide focused on the supervision process, which will be available soon. And these resources are designed to give you clear step-by-step guidance. There were also questions submitted regarding classification of tokens, specifically security tokens. So don't miss our crypto asset classification guide. There's a scheme that helps you classify your token, whether it falls under MiCA, MiFID, or other regulations. And you can find all those resources on our website, BankLV, under the section of operational areas. And of course, if you have any questions regarding pre-licensing process or supervision, we're here to help you. So feel free to reach us through an email, fintech@banklb. And regarding all the links you saw and will see in our presentation, we will publish them later with a recording or on our website fintechlatvia.eu. Okay, that's it from my side. Thank you for your attention. And now we move to the next topic. And I'll hand things over to my colleague, Valters, who will walk you through DORA requirements.
Thank you for the floor. I'll try to go over the DORA regulatory requirements related to ICT and cybersecurity. And as you probably know, DORA regulation scope also includes crypto asset service providers and issuers of asset reference tokens. And Ministry of Finance is drafting digital resilience national law, which is refining DORA concepts and aligning those concepts to other national legal requirements, as well as setting sanction requirements and conditions. So at least the concept of DORA coverage is clear. And as you are going for the licensing process, you have to comply with DORA starting from 2025, January 17th. Here is the summary about the requirements and extension of requirements related to different articles of DORA. And those companies who are familiar with NIST framework, those will recognize those articles 8 to 8.12, which is basically NIST concept. Identify, protect, detect, response, and recover. And then you just need to refine your company policies and strategies to comply with DORA. Otherwise, I would say that ICT risk management framework is the thing where you should start when you are evaluating your DORA readiness. And the highest impact or highest effort you have to put into the company procedures and regulations is response and recovery. And this is partly because of the incident reporting process and different business continuity plans and disaster recovery plans. But overall, I should say, looking on for the number of requirements in each of the areas, it's very extensive work you are going to comply to regulation. So this is the slide where we have summarized the areas where we as regulators will be looking to the licensees. And these four areas are say the basics of the regulation, and it starts with ICT risk management, where the company, financial entity, needs to have in place all the strategies, instructions, regulations, allocated budgets, and finally, to integrate ICT risk management framework into the overall ICT risk management framework of the company. And it's management's ultimate responsibility to implement the risk management framework. ICT incident management is basically the obligation to be able to identify and follow all the ICT incidents and have all the procedures and processes in place that be used to report those incidents to the competent authorities. Operational resilience testing is concerning business continuity plans and disaster recovery plans, and it also should be related to overall ICT risk management framework, so it complies with the framework. And the last part is, which is a novel requirement and one of the most tricky parts, we'll touch it later, but ICP third party risk management involves to the whole process of pre-contract arrangements, contract conclusion, contract terms, and follow up during the whole life cycle of the SAP threat provider services. This is to complement the ICP incident management framework that financial entities are obliged to report all major incidents to competent authorities, which is Latvijas Banka. And it's going through the stages of initial notification, intermediate report, and final report, which is which should include the root cause analysis and remediation plans. Finally, in the year's perspective, financial entities should be able to aggregate all the losses that major incidents are causing or are causing and report it to competent authorities. This is the frame which states or streamlines how major ICT incidents are being categorized or identified. In this case, it's talking on the primary criteria that financial entity need to assess whether two of those criteria are take place. And then in this case, the incident is categorized as a major incident, or in the wider scope, if there are one primary criteria and two secondary criteria, like reputational impact, duration of the incident, then again, the incident is categorized as a major incident. The concept of outsourcing becomes a bit tricky when DORA comes into the place, because currently we see outsourcing or ICT outsourcing as the function that a financial entity would do itself internally, but it's giving to some third party. Then when DORA comes into the play, then there is a concept of third-party ICT provider, which is basically any ICT outsourcing arrangement. It does not matter whether the company was intending to do it itself or internally. And putting those two concepts together, the scope looks a bit different. Though we assume that third-party ICT providers cover at least 80% of all the existing outsourcing arrangements, but the scope of third-party ICT provider is definitely wider. And concluding the presentation, there is overview on the journey how you would adapt to the DORA requirements if you are going to be licensed by Latvijas Banka. We would recommend to start with a gap analysis, which is the result of understanding how your ICT strategy is complementing overall business strategy, perform gap analysis, follow the new requirements of regulatory technical standards, which is the ongoing process. Only four of the technical standards are adopted by the European Commission. So that means, which means in the next few months, four another RTSs and ITSs are coming out and being adopted. If necessary, of course, the consultancy is a useful approach, which might help to prepare you for that. And after gap analysis is done, prepare the implementation plan, ensure that management body has appointed or ensure that there is appropriate budget. Please engage with ICT providers, as it might take time to rearrange all the contracts. And it might be tricky to register all the contracts in the registers of information, which is also part of regulatory requirement, and the forms are defined in the implementation technical standards. And finally, prepare and test ICT reporting, because it may require development of additional systems and time and effort to implement all the thresholds and categories for the incident reporting. So then thank you for your attention. If any questions arise during the process of DORA compliance, then please just email or contact otherwise us and we'll try to help. Thank you.
Thank you, Walter. That was a really insightful for me personally as well. I feel like I finally understand something about the DORA. Now let's keep things moving. I'll hand it over to Eleonora, who will tell us more about the support instruments we offer for the fintech industry.
Thank you, Elena, Valters. So let's see what support for the innovators and the companies we can provide from Latvijas Bank side. This is how we will try to help you to navigate within this jungle of the regulation. As mentioned, I am Eleonora Bušmane-Zvaigzne, and I am leading the Innovation Hub and Regulatory Sandbox. The Innovation Hub is usually our first contact point with our potential market participants who are seeking for the regulatory feedback and expectations on their intended business model. As well, here we meet our existing market participants who are looking for the regulators' advice while working on their new initiatives. You may hint us anytime, and in upcoming few days, we will gather the team of the experts relevant for your case and deep dive into your inquiry. In most cases, in upcoming few weeks, we will agree on a meeting, physical or online, with you. The team you will meet on the side of Latvijas Banka most probably is already familiar for you since your licensing process, or you will soon get familiar with us. Besides, we don't treat this consultations as the formal application process, so you may actually expect quick and personalized feedback. This is our intention to cut communication lines as short as possible. However, if your inquiry is more complex and it's more beneficial to structure our work in a project mode, then welcome to the regulatory sandbox. Regulatory sandbox is another mechanism to support innovative solutions in the financial sector. Entry is open for such products which may disrupt and bring significant contribution to Latvian market and the potential to expand across the whole EU. Your service, for example, could be cheaper, faster, with better user experience, or it may trigger the response from the other financial market service provider, or it decreases the classical supply chains, or includes underserved parts of the society, then you meet the eligibility criteria to apply for this regulatory sandbox. Entry to the regulatory sandbox is open for the companies in different stage of the life cycle. It can be existing licensed financial market participant solely or together with the third party provider. It can be potential market participant or even the third party provider who at the end of the day doesn't even need the license to go live with its product. However, he's still a part of the financial ecosystem. We are flexible to agree with you on a such testing model which fits you the most while within internal or external environment, before, after, or even simultaneously with the licensing. You are ready for the regulatory testing when at least the prototype of your product is developed. You have done preliminary risk assessment and you have defined the scope and the plan for the testing. Regulatory testing is not providing you with the quality stamp that can be publicly promoted afterwards. It also is not providing any exemptions from the existing regulations. Otherwise, how would you survive afterwards in the reality? And it's not a license at the end of the process. However, Latvijas Banka's team in the regulatory compliance professionals are gathered to meet your business needs in areas like AML, IT security, licensing, or prudential supervision. Regulatory experts will observe the testing in all its stages, will provide the feedback, and will participate with a special focus to risk identification, evaluation, and mitigation activities to meet the regulatory expectations and to meet the compliance of this new product. In the other words, this is your no-cost opportunity to supercharge your innovation delivery team with the regulatory compliance. So, feel free and save our contacts fintech@bank.lv and reach out. We are here for you to make a stable, safe, and innovative fintech environment here in Latvia and in Europe. Thank you, Elena.
Yes, a big thank you to Eleonora for that valuable and informative presentation. And as our last speaker for today, I want to take a moment to wrap up and highlight some of the key points we've covered. We've covered a lot of ground today, from understanding the licensing process for CASPs to the key AML requirements that help keep the crypto world safe and compliant. We also dived into how CASPs are supervised, touched on DORA regulation, and explored how innovation can benefit from our regulatory sandbox. But before we finish, I'd like to remind you one second, something's happening with the slides. There is animation, there shouldn't be the one. Okay, now it's good. Before we finish, I'd like to remind you about the fintech Latvia Fintech Forum on November 5th. It's a fantastic opportunity to connect with leaders in the global fintech industry, exchange ideas, and hear about the latest developments. And this event will take place at the Small Guild in Riga, and you can find more details by scanning the QR code on the slide. And as always, if you have any further questions or want to revisit today's topic, the recording and links will be available soon on our website and fintechlatvia.eu. The questions you submitted in the Q&A section that we didn't answer will be reviewed, and we'll provide answers and publish them along with the recording. And also feel free to reach us through an email at fintech@bank.lv. Okay, thank you all for your attention and participation today. We look forward to seeing you at the forum, or perhaps and hopefully in one of our upcoming licensing consultations. Thank you very much.